Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Mist-Filled Path, Celtic Wisdom for Exiles, Wanderers, and Seekers, by Frank MacEowen. Foreword by Tom Cowan. Narrated by Roger Clark. Foreword by Tom Cowan. Druids, poets, and storytellers shared a major responsibility in traditional Celtic communities. They reminded the Celtic people who they were. In former ages, when wisdom stories and sacred histories were not written on the fragile page, where it was feared the tales would fade with the ink or be torn to pieces and lost forever, these keepers of memory orally passed on the wisdom of their people from generation to generation. Every people needs teachers who can tell them where they came from and what they are doing here, or what they should be doing here if they hope to preserve the spiritual values and traditions of their culture and pass them on to their children. Without such teachers, a people dies. A Mist-Filled Path is a book by and about such a teacher, a modern Celt, the initiatory crises that led him to discover who he is, and his impassioned call to the rest of us to find the old paths once again, walk them, and discover the mystic beauties of the many worlds we live in. Frank MacEowen reminds us who we are, or who we could be. Frank really does love the mist. One summer he was a guest at my home in New York's Hudson River Valley, a damp, forested region, especially compared to the arid high plains of Colorado where he was living. One morning I found him sprawled on my porch at dawn, a walking stick across his lap, beads of perspiration running down his face, his boots and pant legs soaked in the morning dew and covered with burrs and stick tights. I asked where he had been. "With the apples and the deer," he answered, and I knew he had risen early to watch the sunrise from the orchard on top of the hill behind my house. The burrs and stick tights were a kind of red badge of courage, his wet boots and cuffs a fleeting keepsake from hill walking in the morning mist. He looked weirdly contented. There are reasons to love the mist, as you will discover in the sections that follow. The mist is a threshold state in Celtic spirituality. It is sacred. We might even think of mist as a sacrament in the old Catholic sense of that term, an outward sign of an interior state of grace. As Frank explains it, mist consciousness is druid consciousness, saint consciousness, shaman consciousness, and Christ consciousness. It is the awareness and perspective of a person standing at the threshold of sacred experience, even as you are now poised on that same threshold, with this beautifully written guide to accompany you in your wayfaring. My own travels with Frank have opened doors and gateways into those invisible realms of our longing, where we catch grail-like glimpses of the goodness for which we yearn. Longing, too, is a holy state for those not afraid, as Frank puts it, to surrender themselves to the great pull that lures us into life, to places we have not yet dreamed of, places where the great shaper of life longs to shape us. Frank MacEowen has felt this lure and followed it, and now invites us to lean into that divine power so that we might discover its presence and then honor and celebrate it in the simple events of our day. Once hiking through the Catskill Mountains, we paused at an old stone well, an ancient spring lined with Catskill bluestone by settlers in the 19th century. It was the kind of thin place where the mysteries of the other world call out to be recognized and honored. So we made some prayers to whatever salmon, trout, or skull might dwell in the invisible depths of the waters. As we left, Frank reverently placed a reddish oak leaf on the blue stone at the head of the well, then a smaller yellow leaf on that. Last, and meticulously, he set a green gem-like pebble from the trail on top of the two leaves. a tender, heartfelt, and gentle offering to the Mother of the Waters, who is the lifeblood of these mountains. Frank does things like that. The Celtic spirit, like the Celtic mind, does not want to get locked into a rigid framework with no way of escape. Like the mist, the spirit wants to shift, rise, disappear, and return. Frank knows this. The rich treasure of Celtic mysticism presented in this book, pagan, Christian, and postmodern, is not a hoard for dragons to guard, but more like a sail to hoist into the wind to let the elements of God decide direction and destination. With an exciting boldness, Frank pulls the old ways out of our many pasts and into the present, but always with a sensitivity to what is authentic and appropriate for these new times and places. Nor is he blind to parallel teachings from other cultures and centuries that support, enhance, and make sense of the older Celtic ways. You will find in this book the indigenous wisdom of Africa, Asia, and Native America, Sufi and Buddhist teachings, some renegade Catholic ideas, and a touch of modern depth psychology, and ideas about social and environmental activism, all seen through a Celtic lens. You can trust this guide as his eye wanders over the vast mystic landscape, and he points out the next stop on our pilgrimage. We are, to use his phrase, people of the wandering fire, and we need to know the geography of the modern world we wander through if we hope to interact intelligently with others of different beliefs and values. If you take this book to heart, it will not make you look like a strange remnant of a lost civilization caught in a modern time warp, trying to find your way back into a mythic past. As presented here, Celtic spirituality is not a romanticized artifact or an atavistic throwback to earlier times, but a modern ethos for dealing with environmental crises, the poor and homeless, the uncertainties of a hostile and dangerous world, and the mind-numbing, spirit-numbing boredom that our consumer culture generates in so many people. Confucius said, "The person who can reanimate the old and in so doing gain knowledge of the new is fit to be a teacher." Frank MacEowen is fit to be a teacher. The Mist-Filled Path is an engaging, lyrically written account of old Celtic ways and a challenging manifesto to live them in the 21st century. You may not be Celtic or even Western, but to study with such a teacher who can reanimate the wisdom of the past so that it sings in your modern heart is a wonderful experience. Late one night, on the Scottish island of Iona, after one of many long and tangled discussions about the nature of the other world, Frank invited me to light a votive candle with him in the chapel of St. Oran, a member of Columbkeel settlers, who founded the first Christian hermitage on that island, which had once been a powerful Druid sanctuary. Legend has it that Oran is buried in a grave beneath this chapel, where he was placed, alive, by Columbkeel, as a sacrificial offering for their new spiritual venture. After 3 days, they dug up the grave to see how he was doing. He was still alive and kicking, and announced, "The other world is nothing like you imagine." Whereupon he was reburied, and, by all accounts, still lives there. Beneath our candle flames, beneath our prayers and vigils, beneath our own imaginings of what those other worlds are like. This book helps us imagine and see those worlds. It helps us prepare for whatever surprises we might eventually discover. In it, you will tromp through burrs and sticktites, make offerings by sacred springs, light candles late in the night. You will realize, I hope, as I did in reading these pages, the great joy that comes from mistwalking. Tom Cohen, Highland, New York, author of Fire in the Head, Shamanism, and The Way of the Saints. Introduction. Waking up in the land of sleepwalkers. The breeze at dawn has secrets to tell you. Don't go back to sleep. You must ask for what you really want. Don't go back to sleep. People are going back and forth across the door sill where two worlds touch. The door is round and open. Don't go back to sleep. Jalal ud-Din Rumi. Our world invites us to become what I call sleepwalkers. Many people, some without even knowing it, have accepted the invitation. When we're not truly alive within our senses, days bleed into days, night after night passes. Too many of us squander our lives, spending them in front of televisions, filling our minds with a crazed habitual raciness that is hard to throw off. I use the word spend on purpose, because the numbered days of our lives are a precious commodity. Where and how we choose to invest our energy and time is of great importance to the soul. Where we choose to place our awareness matters. So many of us have unquestioningly bought the unspoken story that if we plop ourselves down in front of the blinking strobe box, we will be magically transformed by its quicksilver images. Allow me to state the obvious. The good life portrayed there is not good, nor is it truly life. It is not the kind of living that deepens our relationship to authenticity. It is not the kind of life that brings us into contact with wakeful purpose or wonderment, which are our divine birthright. The rumbling of this subliminal world of 30-second soundbite commercials, fueled by the promise of instant gratification, sends millions of us on unconscious, often unscrupulous journeys to the store to obtain more and more things that eventually serve no greater purpose than to clutter our living spaces. This gesture and ritual of accumulation is anchored in an illness within the modern zeitgeist. This illness is one of illusion, thinking that material objects will provide us with the inner satisfaction that, ultimately, can only be gained from valuable, wakeful life experiences. I am not talking about objects that truly help our lives or provide for a deepening and richer experience of our earth walk. Put the right book in the hands of a person at the right time in his or her life, for example, and a transformation occurs. A candle, a framed photograph, a beautiful plant, a rustic desk, a journal. Things like these can often provide for an aesthetic and spiritual doorway to an experience of our lives as a thing of beauty. In effect, they can support us in waking up and staying awake. Nonetheless, even these items are not the same as the actual experience of a deepened and awakened life. Owning a meditation cushion, a yoga mat, or a Scottish walking stick does not automatically grant the achievement of wakefulness. They are only tools. Our homes, packed with all the latest gadgetry and accumulations from our travels, combined with the developed landscapes in which we live, begin to mirror quite succinctly the cluttered quality of the interior life of the modern person. As within, so without. Our living spaces, our city spaces, reflect our minds and souls. Eventually, we get claustrophobic with all the clutter, all the prized possessions crammed into closets. Suddenly, we cannot wait to travel as quickly as possible away from our homes, away from our cities and towns, to some other region. We grow tired of our possessions because they do not fill the void. They do not make us happy. They did not provide us with the sustained and sustainable experience of the inspirited life we were longing for in our bones. We see these objects differently from how we saw them when they were bought. We realize they do not, in the end, soothe the deep ache. In time, our possessions will go the way of the dinosaur, end up in landfills or yard sales, or get passed on to those less fortunate, granting us the brief feeling that we have been charitable. We then start the cycle again. we go for more objects. But a home filled with clutter is no home at all. In the words of Anthony Lawler, author of A Home for the Soul, we want our houses and apartments to be warm, nurturing, and beautiful, but they are sometimes areas of chaos and territories of conflict, isolation, and confusion. The very places that hold the promise of harmony and revitalization can, instead, be abodes of disorder, friction, and loneliness. We are not at home in our homes because we are not at home in ourselves. We are not at home among the living things of the earth. We are not satisfied or content. We are not at home in our minds. We are not at peace. If we look at our habits in the land of the sleepwalkers, we see that, for some, the substance of true intimacy in relationships has been stripped from our vocabulary. The experience of personal human contact has been replaced by the less tangible, less complicated, less challenging, and therefore less honest world of virtual chat rooms. We come and go from our homes and apartments, often with no real sense of who our neighbors are. Slowly but surely, this reality begins to set itself up within our families and marriages, and our relatives and spouses become strangers to us, emotionally and spiritually. A true association or fluency with the inner face of the soul is missing. Intimacy can be read as into me see. It must start with our being willing to look deeply within, into the realm of both our untapped creativity and our shadows that hide in the corners. Intimacy is the human heart opened up to the world, declaring fearlessly, "I invite you to see into me." In the world of the sleepwalkers, intimacy is all too often replaced by anonymity. Many people let years pass without letting others know them deeply. They are just as homeless in their inner lives as people living in cardboard boxes on the street. We have become exiles from one another, exiles from the lives we yearn to live. We have become disenfranchised from our dreams, strangers to our own inner faces, wandering like hungry ghosts for some sense of belonging. Ultimately, this is an exile that we all share. It is a common wound, for it is a collective exile from an enlightened society that we all know is possible. We all share the hope of this potential, this endowment of peace and ease. But for now, we simply keep going, some of us half asleep. The seeds of a society rooted in illumination and wakefulness rest deep inside us. These seeds sleep beneath our own sleeping. They are the seeds of longing shared by all our ancestors. Like the quickening seeds that tremble at the time of Emolc, the tremor of spring in Celtic tradition we ourselves stir. These seeds twitch just beneath a frosty layer of earth and slowly move in their casings. In time, they set their root and begin an upward pilgrimage to the gleaming sun. It is our time to set our root and wake up. Return. My wish for you is a homecoming in this life, a coming in out of the cold, a drying off the icy rain's touch. In the holy reliquary of childhood memory, may you find there the unshakable truth of your preciousness. May you remember the cool and padded graces of your wet feet against stone. In the middle of a long night, a single burning light serving as your peace, may you fold back the pocket holding your slights, your jilted times, your feelings of betrayal, and discover small diamonds there, created from the crushed coal of your hates and rage. May you taste resurrection without the need of dying for it. From Building Fences in High Wind, Poems of Longing, Frank MacEowen. Setting Our Root. Something begins to happen to us when we accept an invitation other than that offered in the land of sleepwalking described earlier. We take a deep and life-affirming breath. We slowly move from a life of exile and wandering to the life of seeking. In this holy seeking, the ordinary becomes holy again, magical. Sleepwalkers begin to wake up. People in pain begin to find solutions. People racked with stress find ways to return to solace. People who feel outside life suddenly experience the blessing of homecoming, punctuated by the realization that there is no such thing as loneliness when one has the powers of the universe flowing through him or her. Equally as powerful is when people who have set their root and have begun to wake up begin to extend their energy and presence into the world as a means of fostering wakefulness in others. Suddenly, a person who felt cut off from others and from the beauty of life becomes an ambassador of this beauty, a shaper of it. Within this beauty lies a deep peace that is, we might say, a central hearthstone of the Celtic tradition. The Celtic spiritual traditions are rooted in peace. Prayers, rituals, daily acts, and orientations focus on fostering peace. In essence, the Celtic spiritual path aims to facilitate three conditions: an opening within the human heart, a sheltering sense of solace in the world for those who struggle, and an ongoing sensual celebration of the beauty of life. These guideposts lie at the heart of the many soul maintenance practices that are performed in these very old traditions. Living a life that fosters these conditions of soul maintenance is what I mean here by setting our root. It is about changing our reality from one of discord to one of harmony. As trembling seeds of a hopeful future, we choose to set our root in what some Celtic theologians call goodness, love, and yearning. This process becomes the path. It becomes a way of changing self and the world. This kind of waking up is noticeable, visceral. People begin dedicating their lives to transforming themselves and the world. People living in city apartments suddenly start saying hello, extending themselves and the range of possibilities for human connection and the human condition. They join one another in instant communities on front porches, and suddenly the air becomes pierced with astonishing questions, such as, "How is it with your soul?" Individuals step out onto the streets and reach out to those living a life of struggle, the hungry, the displaced, the grieving, and ask, "What can I do to help?" People who have felt displaced from the holy landscape of the natural world enter back into the green world and find themselves embraced. People in relationships who have fallen asleep, who have forgotten each other, suddenly remember with immense clarity the preciousness of the person with whom they share a home. They embrace and ask, "Where have you been? Where have I been?" Being willing to entertain such questions as, "How is it with my soul?" requires us to slow down a bit. The willingness to orient our lives to such questions demands that we slow down a lot. If we are to truly set our roots in such soil, we must aspire to create sanctuaries of the stillness in our lives. We must find our places of resurrection. As it is spoken of in the Celtic Christian tradition, we must rediscover our ancient house of memory. Imagine giving yourself a potent gift. I will describe it to you as a practice. Practice: setting your root. Clear out a room in your home. Put some things in storage. Better yet, sell or donate them. Set aside a space specifically for consecrating a brief retreat that will focus on setting your root. Make this space a place to honor the ancient rhythms. Make it a place where you can be without distraction. Now choose a day over the course of a weekend. In our busy lives, finding such time has become difficult, yet it is possible and merely requires a commitment. Plan in advance. Set aside a Saturday, perhaps, with the full knowledge that this day is your day. Ask friends or family to support you in this endeavor. Upon entering the room for what will be an entire day, dawn to dusk, watch what happens to your mind. There will be no email, no World Wide Web, no television, no telephone, no dinner dates, no ritualized habits. There will be no movies, no coffee, no cigarettes, no alcohol, just the quiet edges of your soul being still. The tremor of your mind engaged in reclaiming your place in a more ancient rhythm. When we remove ourselves from the unnatural rhythms of the world, the more ancient rhythm of our earth selves returns. This is nature's healing power on us and within us, for we are part of nature. Once you've made room, the questions come. For some people, so do the fears, doubts, and worries. Stay with the questions that arise. Stay with the fears. Stay with the boredom. For undoubtedly your mind will continue to spin. Your mind will say, "But I could have taken a trip this weekend. I should have done some yard work. I should really do my taxes." Think of these things as a cold wind and turn yourself instead toward the warm, sweet, sheltering spirit of silence. Stay with your questions and think of this act as warming your earth. It is like the sun thawing the frosty ground. Chew on the questions, the doubts, and the fears. Feel them to be what they really are. The necessary magnetism of moistness and warmth to activate the seeds of wakefulness within you. Where a moist chill meets warmth, the luminescence of mist is born. The mist is the threshold, the guardian of the in-between where vision is received. Within the mist of liminal time and space, we are able to plant the seeds of a new life. Remember that the seed is you and me and the soulful life we long for. Use this time for setting your root. Think about what soil you want your soul to take root in now. Open yourself to vision. Open your heart to feeling. Face the fear of not knowing. Welcome all your doubts, and know that they too are companions and guides in this process. When you are ready to set your root, stand and face the four directions, starting with the east, the direction of the new rising sun. Move in a clockwise fashion, what is called Jishil, or sunwise, in the old Gaelic tradition. Announce out loud what you are setting your root in. Perhaps you are setting your root in waking up, in remembering sacred world, in coming back to your senses. Perhaps you're setting it in healing, in cultivating gentleness with yourself, in fostering a sense of true self-respect. Perhaps you are throwing off the shackles of a self-absorbed, materialistic life and are now setting your root in a life of kindness and service to others. In any case, speak this commitment, the new root of your life. Speak it out loud. Speak it to everything, to your ancestors, to the earth and sky, to the unseen world. When you have set your root, know this. Everything in your life, from the time of your stated commitment forward, becomes like the seed sending its shoot toward the sun. Your root is set. The seed that is your heart is now committed to being open. It is time to begin. Having set your root, you are now looking for the sun, which is the same as a wakeful life. Feel the sun on your brow. Let the solar power, the great wheel of light, pull you. When you are ready, slowly enter back into connection with others dear to you. like the young sapling that emerges from the ground into the light of day, greet the world, but also, like a young sapling, you must take great care. In facing the world again, remember that the world does not know or understand what kind of soil you have emerged from. People will not necessarily know that you have undergone a change. What do you notice in facing the world again? You have spent an entire day in this process. You have announced your new route, your commitment to the powers of life. But now you must share it with your community, with your family of blood and spirit. Ask for their support in assisting you to live a life rooted in this new energy. The mist-filled path awaits you. Note: once you have performed this day-long practice, you can expand it into a full weekend. Or perhaps, if you are at a significant crossroads in your life, you would be served by doing this practice for a full week. Reclaiming our holy senses. Many of you, upon hearing the previous suggestions, will recoil at the notion of both the stark surroundings and the extended solitude. For we have been conditioned to fear both. Many of us have been conditioned to fear ourselves, including the deeper call of our life passions. Certain schools, churches, and even families create distrust of our primal knowing and intuition. In light of such an inheritance, it is no wonder that most of us have grown up not trusting ourselves, not knowing who we really are, and not knowing how to create the life we want. We sense something more, but the chasm between here and there feels as wide as a galaxy. In a culture that measures worth by how much we own or by what we do, it is a radical act to investigate who we truly are beyond our property values or professional titles. Equally as radical is the act of inviting extended moments of silence to recover our more ancient senses. It is precisely from these recovered holy senses that we are granted potential methods and solutions for dealing with the undeniable pains that grip our souls today. Senses, much like muscles, can become atrophied over time without exercise and use. This is especially true of our ancestral, primal, and spiritual senses. According to Basque mystic and anthropologist Angeles Arian, the Basque people have mapped out 137 senses, far above and beyond the more well-known five senses of sight, hearing, smell, taste, and touch. 137 senses that are possible for us to use and access, nearly all of which can only be cultivated by giving ourselves over to a slower, more ancient earth rhythm. The modern pace does not allow for such slowness and silence. Meditation or contemplation is often perceived as lifeless inactivity. Many people fear that slowing down will cause them to miss something, and yet it is our society's velocity that is causing us to miss something very important. Besides the attrition of what I call our otherworldly senses, we have also lost the ability to have a moment-to-moment awareness of our passage through life. On many occasions, I have heard people remark that they feel out of place, out of sorts, depressed, or bored, when a true moment of quiet descends on them. This is how fundamentally exiled we are from the natural texture of our own silence. As modern people, we don't know what to do with this great teacher of teachers. She can be an uncomfortable teacher and guide, yet great power and healing wait in the folds of silence and solitude. Mirroring the creation of the universe, all great things have come forth from the ancient weave of silence. It is a part of us we must welcome home. Yet in the land of the sleepwalkers, silence is avoided at all costs. For many, There is only collapse at the end of the day from all the effort expended to avoid looking, to avoid feeling, to avoid authentic contact, to avoid admitting our misery or suffering. All too often, yet another day devoid of freedom and true awareness awaits on the other side of a stirring, dreamless night. Another path exists, however. Oddly enough, it is already beneath our feet and is accessible in this very moment. It says, "Don't go back to sleep. You must ask for what you really want. The breeze at dawn has secrets to tell you. People, many of them, our own ancestors and the souls of great teachers who wish for us a liberated existence, are going back and forth across the door sill, where two worlds touch. The door is round and open. Don't go back to sleep." The purpose of this book. This book is not an anthropological thesis about the Celtic world. It is not an archaeological treatise on the Iron Age Celts, or even specifically a scholarly or historical exploration of Celtic regions and culture. Scholars and historians with far more ability than I have already given the world an immense gift in the form of their works. My intention here is not to reinvent the wheel, but rather to articulate how we may truly live in the spirit of the wheel, an ancient symbol used in the druidic traditions of Ireland, the shamanic traditions worldwide, and even in the Celtic Christian tradition of earth-honoring mysticism. This sacred wheel is the cycle of our days, the circle of our horizon, the Celtic wheel of living. The central aim of this book is to articulate a way of seeing the world and a possible way for being in it that re-enlivens a relationship to that which is holy. I have come to call this the mist-filled path. Mist being a teacher or tutelary spirit for me in my childhood. It is an invitation into a slower, more ancient earth rhythm, as it has been worked within the living streams of perennial Celtic spirituality, animism, druidic philosophy, shamanism, and mysticism. It is a particular kind of orientation. One that looks to restore the ancient dialogue between the human being and the sacred world. A portion of this book involves descriptions and accounts of experiences I have had that fall within the domain of the transpersonal, the paranormal, and the shamanic. I share these experiences not only to illuminate the themes and principles we are working with, but also to normalize the non-ordinary, the otherworldly, and the transpersonal dimensions of human experience. All strands of human experience that our world has largely lost. Some of these experiences involve spirits, ancestors, nature, and other presences not so easily defined. But these are not supernatural. These things are simply natural. My personal experiences are rooted in my own journey of waking up to my life that occurred through a deep depression, a near-fatal illness, and a unique cellular initiation into the realms of Celtic mysticism. I have come to refer to this process as ancestral transmission. Other aspects of this book include visionary exercises, meditations, and other reflections. My only instructions regarding these practices, other than those contained in the actual description of them, is to open yourself to the spirit or concept that is being explored and see how it resonates with your life path. These small stopping places on the path are designed to foster a process of deepening with the themes of this book. These guiding themes are undoubtedly anchored in the life-affirming spirituality of my ancient Celtic ancestors, yet I have strived to discern ways to apply these themes to the here and now, the life each of us has and the world that each of us faces, whatever our ancestral background. From a Celtic perspective, the sacred world is vast. It includes our ancestors, the spirit world, the world of nature, the human world, and the rich inner world of each person as expressed through dreams. The sacred world, as it worked with in Celtic tradition, is replete with thresholds of opportunity, renewal, and healing. I have strived to design the flow of this book to mirror these thresholds. And yet, as Esther Duval has said of the Celtic spiritual path, it is not necessarily one that follows a clear-cut pattern of having some end and goal in view, so that the purpose can be clearly established and then followed. For the really significant journey is the interior journey. Thus, this book may feel to the listener a bit like the flowing cords of Celtic knotwork one sees in both pre-Christian and post-Christian Celtic art. We will weave back in on themes at times in service of remembrance and deepening. At times it may feel as if we have doubled back onto familiar ground. This flowing weave represents the nature of holy dialogue in Celtic tradition, which encounters the sacred world once via the journey or quest, and a second time via pilgrimage and remembrance. The mist-filled path, as a spiritual vision, is characterized by communion and holy contact with what we will call here the in-between, those thresholds of numinosity and liminality, or in Rumi's words, those luminous places where two worlds touch, opening ourselves to this kind of contact, encounter, and dialogue with life, as well as having a willingness to hang out with the unknown, are all characteristic of the Celtic spirit. These same qualities are one I hope that you will feel supported in cultivating. The mist-filled path is not about sequined magical robes, long-lost priesthoods, or stereotyped media notions of Celts, druids, shamans, and mystics. Though undoubtedly influenced by the ancient legacy of the druidic tradition, with its love of nature and emphasis on merging with the sacred, this book is more generally about our collective human tradition of making life holy. It is about finding true magic in every moment by reclaiming a view and experience of the sacred world that is already around and within us. It is about welcoming the influence of the sacred world and orienting ourselves to the sacred questions in our hearts. This book is a revisioning from a Celtic perspective of the invitation that all the contemplative and shamanic traditions have extended to us over time. It is an invitation to slow down and to ask important questions, such as, what uncharted roads in the landscape of your soul await you? How are you a conduit for healing energies that our world is in such dire need of? What is your calling? The compass of our questions. Our questions speak quite profoundly about the quest we are on. Whether or not we ever receive an answer, just posing certain questions about our lives is a process of soft illumination into the shaded domains of our inner world. The nature and quality of our inner worlds shape the malleable outer world in which we all live. As John Perkins, author of such books as Psychonavigation and The Spirit of the Shuar, has so often said, the world is as we dream it. Friends, this is such important work. We underestimate our power as shapers of the world. We also underestimate the power of the world to shape us in ways that are unholy. This book is about this holy path of shaping and being shaped. It is about aiming our consciousness at the right places and realizing that the questions we hold in our hearts are like hands on clay. The haphazard and frenetic pace of our lives makes asking important questions like these difficult. Actively observing extended periods of silence to sit with these pivotal questions becomes almost an act of anarchy against the ego and our consumerist conditioning. In following this path, we place ourselves firmly in the flow of an ancient legacy of people who have grappled with the questing questions, who have risen to challenge sleepwalking of any form. The mist-filled path is about stepping in among them. As Buddha said, make of yourselves a lamp. The Celtic spiritual traditions originate in this same ancient legacy. From the Druidic tradition of wise men and wise women to the followers of Christ in the Celtic world, the Celtic spiritual pathways are a multifaceted emerald that gleams with the light of an intelligent and sentient creation. To make of ourselves a lamp in this sometimes dark world, we must ally ourselves with this holy light of creation. The Celtic way is steeped in this process of alliance. It is a brightly woven cloak of wisdom and experience that is one of the precious antidotes to the spiritual pain of our era. What visionary Irish poet and mystic William Butler Yeats called an outworn heart in a time outworn. This book comes from my own heart, from one who has been a sleepwalker, who has struggled, who was raked across the coals of initiation, so to speak, and now walks a path of learning from the sacred world, endeavoring to listen deeply for the instructions from the sacred world and the many worlds in between. These common sense yet profound instructions are timeless. They are the perennial roots of the Celtic traditions, and they are about the heart that has announced, I am not going back to sleep. I will feel, I will sense, I agree to shape and to be shaped by my life. This strand of primal Celtic wisdom is about coming by a fresh vision and looking out onto the landscape of the earth and of our lives and whispering prayerfully, yes, I appreciate life and my place within it. I stand in the heart of my life. In this way, the mist-filled path, when practiced authentically, is a path that bursts the heart open and causes us to truly remember our place in the family of things, as poet Mary Oliver puts it. On such a path, as I say in one of my own poems, all people are the chosen ones, all the earth our holy land. Chapter 1. The Threshold of the Mist. The Celts believed that there was another dividing line that all people could straddle, if only they stretched themselves a bit. And that's the divide between the world and the other world. Steve Raybury, in the House of Memory. The mist called to me when I was a child. In the early mornings, and sometimes at dusk, I would look out the window into the thick woods behind our Georgia home, and a deep longing would fill my soul. The Cymry, the Celts of Wales, would say I had been consumed by the spirit of Hiraeth, the longing for something my soul had known once upon a time. Just beyond the mossy stone wall, just past the clusters of fern, I would often see the eerie grey-green mist swirling in the trees. It would hang there like a gull in the wind, as if searching for something. It seemed to capture something of my own quest, a deep childhood search for an experience of the mystery of the sacred world. Some mornings I went outside to see the mist, up close and personal, and just as I would arrive at its edge, it would suddenly disappear from view, almost as if it had never been there. A strange, shadowy afterimage would remain. At other times I would look on with astonished eyes as the mist changed directions and moved away from me, visibly retreating from my presence. It would glide along the tree line, withdrawing itself from my overly analytical stare. In truth, my precocious and unrefined piercing gaze was exiling me from the teachings of the mist. I am reminded of the words of the beloved Irish mystic, Connemara poet, and nature priest John O'Donoghue, who states, there is an unprecedented spiritual hunger in our times. More and more people are awakening to the inner world. A thirst and hunger for the eternal is coming alive in their souls. This is a new form of consciousness. Yet one of the damaging aspects of this spiritual hunger is the way it sees everything in such a severe and insistent light. The light of modern consciousness is not gentle or reverent. It lacks graciousness in the presence of mystery. When the spiritual search is too intense and hungry, the soul stays hidden. The soul was never meant to be seen completely. The soul possesses an ineffable intelligence that cannot be controlled. Like the mist, the soul, we might say, has a mind of its own. It cannot be forced, directed, or squeezed into a box where it does not belong. It cannot even be fully seen or perceived, for the soul is a timeless, feathered thing that flies in more worlds than one. We can see, in tangible ways, the choices that the soul makes in service of itself. When a person is treated horribly, physically or emotionally assaulted, for instance, a fragment of his or her soul may slink off to a hidden, unseen place where it cannot be harmed. In shamanist traditions, this phenomenon is called soul loss. The soul knows what is needed for survival and returns again only when conditions are right, or when someone engages in the work of inviting its fullness home. In this way, the soul preserves itself. The soul's brilliance has allowed for this useful mechanism to ensure the continuity of the consciousness of the living person during his or her life, and sometimes even between lives. All too often, however, when the soul elects to hide part of itself, it does not return very easily. When this happens, we can say that although some external survival has been ensured, a condition of exile has also been created. It is an exile from the flowing awareness of peace that is our birthright. Our lives are meant to be steeped in peace, yet when we are living within a state of soul loss, our destined unfoldment toward a life of peace is postponed until we have become whole again. We feel beside ourselves until we are reintegrated after a harsh experience or trauma. This is as true for whole groups that have survived a trauma as it is for individuals. A word about exile. Exile is that undeniable sensation of being cordoned off from what is most essential to our souls. Perhaps we have become exiled from our childhood memories because of things that happened when we were young. We may be exiles from a basic sense of joy in our lives. Sometimes our exile is characterized by our sense of being a stranger in our own families, not able truly to share who and what we are without being criticized or judged. Family, in the Celtic sense, is meant to feel like a warm hearth fire, a downy nest of repose, and yet all too often our families contain the fiercest of blades that slash at the peace of our souls. For many of us, a kind of exile may lie at the very heart of our lives. It is an exile many people feel in the 21st century. It may express itself as an exile from nature, from ancestral traditions, from cultural homelands, or from spiritual lineages. Sometimes these lineages and traditions appear to be lost forever, without the potential of reclamation, so the exile feels even more poignant. In a very similar fashion, many people feel a dynamic sense of exile from an even closer domain than cultural homelands. They feel that they have been exiled from the interior lands and borderlands of their own spirit, no longer knowing the entrance to this realm or the routes of navigation once inside. They become exiled from the holy realm of the inner worlds. This is a profoundly sacred world in the Celtic tradition, one that those on Celtic spiritual paths actively seek to work with daily, because it is understood that our inner landscape is one entryway to the spiritscape of the other world. An old therapeutic axiom in Gestalt psychology, which also lies at the very heart of shamanism and contemplative mysticism worldwide, suggests that the healing of a wound must come from the blood of the wound itself. In other words, the healing of an emotional or psycho-spiritual wound is brought about precisely by entering into its terrain, not by avoiding it. In this way, healing our exile from our inner world comes from entering that inner world in search of the healing life force we need, the blood within the wound. The healing of our exile from the life-affirming expressions of our ancestral traditions comes from opening ourselves to these traditions of primacy in the same way that our ancestors did. Whoever our particular ancestors were, and whatever unique spiritual traditions may have shaped and sculpted them. And, last but not least, the healing of our exile from the natural world is linked with the practice of entering into a full and loving embrace of her, and once again acknowledging the healing power of the primal land. The healing of the soul of the earth and our relationship with her does not come about by closing ourselves off or by separating ourselves through our definitions, categorizations, and Latin nomenclature, but rather by opening ourselves dynamically to the mysteries of the spiritscape of nature in a soulful and experiential way. To rediscover the sacred world, we must re-enter it with wakeful physical and spiritual senses. I sometimes think that when we experience soul loss or soul exile, it is as if we have had our ancient citizenship revoked. We no longer have diplomatic status to travel freely into the inner sanctum of our own deeper senses or our deepest levels of knowing about the world around us. When we are in this condition, we sometimes need to do what friend and African shaman Maladoma Somme calls setting up a squawk. We must set up a squawk and call the soul parts home. Mist as a trickster teacher. Although we sometimes can call or sing exiled soul parts home, many times it is we who are living in a state of exile, not pieces of our souls. We are the ones who feel hidden from the soul of life, from the soul of the world. We begin to have the sneaking suspicion that we are the part of our ancient soul's memory that has forgotten our place in the grand scheme of things. In cases like these, sometimes the spirits, or sometimes the forces within nature, such as the fairy folk, as perceived of in Celtic seership, will conspire to trick us through synchronicity, dreams, or outward events. Then it is almost as if we stumble into a process of learning a path that will lead us home. This path, at once illuminative yet seemingly hidden, is a road marked by a distinctive vibration. Its energy is of primal forces inhabiting a primal landscape that yearn for us to remember. My initial experience of the mist was like this. It played tricks on me. It attempted to reveal a deeper phenomenon that was all around me, but to which I was, in effect, blind. I did not have the eyes with which to perceive the teachings of the mist when I first encountered them. Nonetheless, the mist got my attention in various ways, alerting me to the fact that to find the sacred within life, I must cultivate the proper eyes with which to see the world. Cultivating sacred eyes is what Celtic spirituality holds as a silent wish for each of us. My childhood tutelage with the mist began in earnest only after I loosened my soul and softened my piercing gaze. Until then, my eyes did not allow me to see the magic of life around me. In time, however, I slowly came to understand that when approaching nature and spirit, one must enter these realms with a gentle openness of heart. We cannot make demands when encountering the sacred world. it is the overly analytical perception of reality, as well as the belief that we are somehow owed an experience that immediately exiles us from the richness of the numinous power around us, within us, and within the earth. We have to be open. We must be, as the eloquent Zen tradition tells us, empty cups, ready to be filled, without preconceived notions of what awaits us. In time, I experienced a gradual settling in my evolving childhood mysticism. It was a settling of my striving. This settling informed me that the sacred was all around me, and that, in addition to developing the proper eyes with which to see, I must also cultivate the proper feet with which to walk the path. One gains the proper eyes and proper feet, I have found, by slowing down. A verse from the rediscovered Gospel of Thomas comes to mind, which states, "His followers said to him, 'When will the kingdom come?' He replied, 'It will not come by watching for it. It will not be said, "Look, here it is," or "Look, there it is." Rather, the Father's kingdom is spread out upon the earth, and people do not see it." Verse 113. As a little boy, I came to associate the mist with special times that I would take for myself, though at the time I was too young to have a working concept of spirituality or spiritual practice. At the mere age of 6, I was becoming aware of the delicious sensation of experiencing the soul of place. I would curl up for hours in one of my sitting places in the forest behind our house, a large oak tree behind me, an old holly tree beside me. I would be quiet, I would be still, and, with a soft gaze, I would watch the unfettered flow of a patch of ground that grew to love me. I was developing the soft eyes of my ancestors. Several years later, I would have a conversation with an Anishinaabe, Ojibwe man from Canada, and I would hear him speak about the necessity of hunting or walking in nature with a soft gaze. He explained, "The four-legged and the winged ones live to a different rhythm. Theirs is the rhythm of soft eyes and soft feet. Two-legged have hard eyes and hard feet. When most humans go into the forest, they enter with so much of the world on them that any possibility of feeling the sacred is removed. When we go into the forest, we must become soft, like the animal people and the tree people." This rhythm of softness is something the mist taught me in the woods of Georgia. I sometimes think back on these childhood experiences and find myself laughing with delight at the name still held for the forested area where we lived, Druid Hills. Many of the trees are now gone, owing to the incessant influence of development. The old house is now gone. The landscape of this mysterious place of childhood awakening has now been taken over by ticky-tacky houses that seemed to go up overnight. Nonetheless, the old oak still stands tall there, along with the holly and the stone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.